Doesn't matter what the people say. There's something mighty sweet. Amen. Once I wandered out in sin, far from God away. But the dear Savior took me in. He gave me sweet peace. That day, all my heart to Him I've given, no more sin allow. I've just heard from heaven, and it's all right now. I've just heard from heaven, and this one thing I know. My sins are all forgiven. He washed them as white as snow. The load that once I carried, He took away somehow. I just heard from heaven, and right now, trials come to you and me. The burdens get hard to bear, but our heartaches, grief, and pain, He said He'd be so glad to share. So just look up and trust in Him. Leave all of your burdens right there. He will hear from heaven when you call in prayer. Sing,
I've just heard from heaven, and this one thing I know. My sins are all forgiven. He washed it white as snow. The love that once I carried, He took away somehow.
I just heard from heaven, and it's all right now. When this old load gets hard to bear, and my path grows dim, no one seems at all to care, I'll just go to Him. He's my intercessor there, so at His feet I bow. I've just heard from heaven, and it's all right now. I've just heard from heaven, and this one thing I know. My sins are all forgiven. He washed them as white as snow. The load that once I carried, He took away somehow. I just heard from heaven, and it's all right now. Amen. May we pray. Our Father, now we've had a good time up until now. The choir specials and singing is so good. The special music, and then the congregation entering in heartily. And it seemed like everybody glad they came this way tonight. Our Father, we're fixing to do what You called us to do, and that's preach. And we can't preach except the power of God. Lord, You said there was a man sent from God whose name was John. And Lord, I pray that You'll let me be one of Your sent ones tonight. Lord, send me. I was thinking of that scripture, Lord, this afternoon where You said, pray that the Lord of the harvest would thrust them. Lord, we need that thrust tonight. We pray for a heavenly thrust. Lord, these old jet planes loaded with 200 or 300 people have enough thrust to climb up to 40,000 feet and haul them 600 miles an hour, and they call that thrust. Lord, we need a spiritual thrust tonight. Thrust us into this harvest field of Rochester Hills. Lord, bless our visitors and our guests, and grant, Lord, that this will be the smallest crowd we'll ever have here during this meeting. But from now on, and the people will come, draw them in. You said, and if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw men unto me. And I pray to draw them and help us to give a good witness tomorrow. And tonight when we get home and where we go to work in the morning and on the school campuses, and I pray that the members of this church will get on their spiritual quarter horses and round up the people and bring them in to hear the gospel, knowing time is just fixing to kiss eternity. And all be over except eternity. God bless us. Bless the pastor. Bless the visiting preachers in Jesus' name. Amen. I thought today I'd like to preach some sermons on the great passages or great chapters of the Word of God. As the Lord, the first one tonight is Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53. And I think, as I heard somebody pray tonight, and the thought came to me concerning Hebrews chapter 11. So the Lord, because you know, chapter 11 is our theme chapter for our entire ministry, the great chapter on faith. And I hope you'll be prepared about Saturday night, if the Lord so leads, for us to preach on that text that's recorded four times, "Now the just shall live." How? By faith. Just by faith. And without faith, it's hard. No, it's impossible to please God. You can't please Him with your works. And you can't please Him with your sight. You please Him by your faith. You know why? It's because the only thing that pleases God is what God does. What you do doesn't please God unless He does it. The old psalmist said, "But they may know, Lord, that Thou hast done it." I want them to know who did this thing. My daddy used to get on the phone, four rings on 187, way out in the country. And I've heard him 1,000 times, I guess. "Hello?" But, I mean, if it wasn't too far away, wasn't then he'd been on the phone. "Hello?" You know what he'd ask next? "Who's doing the talking?" Amen. He wanted who's doing the talking. "Brother, tonight let's figure out who's doing the talking. If it's Lester Olof, you can go now. If it's God, you better stay till it's all over." Faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the Word of God. I was talking to one of the flight services today, or somebody along the trail on the radios, and at least I thought I was. But he was on one frequency and I was on another. We had to get together before we could converse. And I told him directly, he said, "Well," he called back at me, and I said, "It's my fault. I had the wrong frequency on the transmitting radio." Folks, tune in tonight. Isaiah chapter 53, who has believed our report? Who? I tell you what, that verse I've raised it many a time. In my preaching in these 41 years, I remember one night I was in Arkansas and I preached, and the people were there. We prayed that they'd come and visited, and they were there. They filled the house. It is packed and jammed. We thought that'd be the key hour. We thought that'd be the time. We got them there. The people had worked. And yet, at the close of the service, the old devil had moved in to somehow paralyze and keep the people, I mean, from doing what I never forget. And I was so heartbroken till I climbed out the window, jumped out the window, ran to my bedroom, and I raised the question, "Who hath believed our report?" One morning, I was in Georgia with Paul Aiken, big, fashionable church. Balcony was packed, and the once-a-week folks came that morning. I mean, they sat down all over that big auditorium, similar to this one, and we preached. And that was our only opportunity to get at the people. That's the only time. In other words, the people came with attitude, "Do your best, buddy. This is the only time you shoot at me while you're here. I'll not be showing up anymore." And they came. That Sunday morning crowd, that 11 o'clock crowd, came in sort of like Catholics going to Mass. And there they were. This is it. I remember the norther was blowing as cold, and I tell you, the service was so difficult, and I ran out behind the pulpit and down the road and ran all the way home that morning saying, "Who hath believed our report?" They didn't believe it. I'm wondering tonight how many is going to believe the report. I'm going to make a report from heaven. I'm going to report God's reportings tonight. I've got good news for you, but unless you believe it, you will not profit by it.
Who
hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed?
Well, I can tell you that.
The arm of the Lord is revealed to the one who believes the report. You sit there full of unbelief tonight and say, that's not for me. And I just can't bring myself to believe it. Night before last, I sat in my living room at home. And an old broken-hearted daddy came, and his wife. That was their second trip. That was their second trip, nearly 500-mile trip both ways. They came down first on Sunday and said, Brother Olaf, my boy is in jail. He's 39 years old. My grandchild was mixed up with him. They got both of them. Little old 15-year-old boy. Little old Glenn. Little Glenn, big Glenn. And said he's on a $10,000 bond. And said if I go make his bond and get him out. Said, could I bring him down here? I said, yes. You can bring him down. I had Little Glenn before down at the lighthouse, and Little Glenn was a smart aleck, and he didn't want to stay. But we trimmed his hair and made him look like a little gentleman. And he made some progress, and very sweet, cute boy in many ways, but he just wanted to go back to Houston. He wanted to get back, you know. I'm growing up. And down in the coastal 40 miles, and where they catch about a ton of fish, 2,000 pounds of fish a week on rods and reels. Beautiful speck of trout. And our girls, they catch hundreds of pounds of fish at number 9. Really do. And so, you know what happened? Night before last, here came the mother and daddy back. And I was dealing with some people there that a boy that just got out of jail and has been in crime all of his life. And I went down to the jailhouse and paid off his remaining part of his fine, bailed his old car out of the car pound, and we were sitting there talking, and just so many things happening, trying to get away and get ready to leave yesterday morning, and in came this, knocked on the door, and in came this family, and they brought the boy and his boy. You talk about a challenge. I said, I knew I had to build his faith. You talk about hard. Listen, he's as hard-looking critter as I ever saw in my life, but that's the kind we deal with. And I mean, little folks are getting hard now. They're the killers. Little teenagers, they're the killers.
That's right.
Oh, you talk about hatred. You talk about loving the devil and hating God and hating the parents. And we deal with them all the time. Such as we got a bunch of them in the homes right now. But he came in and sat down. I mean, his old face, you could tell that sin had done its work. 39 years of age, little old 15-year-old son said. And I said, hi, Glenn. I said, son, you didn't stay with me long enough, did you? If you'd stayed, you wouldn't be in the trouble with me now. I wish you'd stayed, man. There his hair was, grown again. And the little fella had gone back in a rebellion. His daddy's sitting over there as hard as nails. I went and got 2 Liberty Bells, and I said, I want you to look through here. That little girl at the age of 13 had a criminal record. There's a girl right there that attempted suicide 8 times in the mental hospital. She became salutatorian. And there's a boy that was a thief right there, old Ricky. And his dad had been sent to Penn. Now he's graduating from Tennessee Temple this year, just gone to be associate pastor this summer. And there's old Bill Blackstone. We finally got him 10 years probation. He's standing just outside the judge's chamber right there. And he's married to a beautiful little girl now. And he's in Tennessee Temple School and has finished 1 year. And he's guilty of 4 times pushing dope and heroin and everything else. And so the judge said, son, stand up. And he gave him 10 years in the pen and said, I'm going to give you because of your faith in Christ and your profession of faith. And you say you're saved and been called a priest. I'm going to let you have probation. And I said, there's old Mike Delenty. Old Mike Delenty, I said, he was a gathering demoniac, whiskers down on his chest from his chin and face and dirty and old hair down over his shoulders and the dope pushing. I said, there he is serving God full time. And I said, there's Bill Henderson who put the pistol in the face of a policeman and said, drive me to get a load of dope. Said, I'll shoot your dirty brains out. And I mean, that criminal sat there. And made the officer drive him until after a while they got a hold of him and took the pistol away from him. I finally got him 10 years probation. And you might remember Bill Henderson, Brother Winston, Tennessee Central School, graduated, pastor in the lovely church. And I said, there's old Harold Pennington, on dope for 12 long years from Houston. Bill was from Houston. And he's been saved and delivered all the week. And there's old Mike Hagee right there. And I showed him these. I said, there's Mike Hagee. Judge said, stand up in the court yonder in Atlanta, Georgia. He said, I'll give you 5 years in the pen. We came along and he said, all right, let you have him. See what you can do with him. He has a boy's home in Tennessee right now preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And there's old Danny Kent right there on dope for 13 long years. That lovely wife you see there got in the pen 3 times because of his dope. 3 times he went to the penitentiary. And now that he's an evangelist preaching the gospel, graduated with honors, written up in Who's Who. I went over all this with him a little bit and, boy, he folded that thing up and put it down. He said, I don't believe that stuff. I don't believe it. I just don't believe in God. I never did go to church. I don't believe that stuff. I looked at that old hardened criminal night before last, and I said, I know why you don't believe it. You haven't been around people to believe it. You've run with the dope-shooting crowd, with the drinking crowd, with the ungodly crowd, but you're caught now. I said, though you don't believe it, I'll give you one thing to know, and that is, I do believe it. And look what it's done for me, and look what your unbelief has done for you.
Amen.
No nervous sinner and criminal's head. I don't want to go to jail. I don't want to go to prison. I don't want to stay another jail any longer. He said, I don't want to stay out. His daddy just signed his bond. And he said directly, I'm willing to give it a try. I said, that's all you need to do, brother. Just go down there and get exposed to it. The gospel will do the rest. This old gospel hammer will break his old hard heart. And the most stony heart, it'll break it to pieces. I believe that. Hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed, for he should grow up as a tender plant, as a tender plant, and as a root out of a what? Dry ground. I tell you, he came from a dry ground, didn't he? I was reading yesterday about Ezekiel in the valley of dry bones. God said, take a walk around. Walk down through the valley of dry bones, no bones laying out. And he said, the Lord asked him, see, crying out his faith. He said, can these bones live? And I think old Brother Ezekiel, who became the captain of the captives of Kibar, and he said, I sat where they sat. And brother, you'll never help them till you sit down where they sit. Till you walk in their lonely shoes. Until you know their heartaches. The fact they never had a chance up until now. You'll never, never be able to hit them. He said, I sat where they sat. Can these bones live? I think Ezekiel said, far as I'm concerned, they can. But he said, thou knowest. Thou knowest. Brother, wasn't very long till the more bones got together. You remember that? Don't you know it's an exciting time? People talk about the dull Christian life. Brother, ain't nothing dull about it. I mean, over here where I am.
Amen.
Most exciting place and thing I ever saw in my life. I mean, you know, outside of jail today and inside tomorrow and outside the next day and going on. I mean, God gives you just a many wonderful opportunities and friends and joy and singing and the presence of the Lord. Brother, listen, there's one thing I found out. There's no duplication in the Christian life. I mean, there's no repetition. There's no monotony in the Christian life, buddy. Every day is a brand new day because His mercies are new every morning. His compassions fail not. They're new, He said, every morning. But for His mercy, I'd already been consumed. And so He said, Lord, Thou knowest. Can you imagine excitement? Old brother Ezekiel walking through the valley of dry bone, him old bone getting up walking around. Old bones, I mean, you know, knee bone looking for an ankle bone.
Brother. Oh, Elbow looking for a hand. Where's my hand?
Old hand said of here I am. Come over and get connected. Brother, in a little while, them old bones are still there. And they're standing there, wasn't it? That's right. Them old bones, they had no life. God had to put life in. Reminds us of a lot of our Sunday morning churches, doesn't it, huh? Old dry bones getting together. the preacher, he don't say it, but he ought to say, well, I'm glad to have another meeting of the dry bones. And Ezekiel said they were very dry. Terrible drought for them, wasn't it? It's about the way it is. We don't want to have no meetings of the dry bones now. Listen, God breathed upon them. He breathed upon them. Them old bones had life. And I tell you, he said, I can do the same thing with Israel too. And I can put all them bones together, and I can make an army out of them. I'll make a real army. Did you see what he said? He said, I'll make an army out of them. You know what an army's supposed to do? Fight. Army not supposed to just go get their war. Well, you got to fight before you get in the middle. Got to have a few scars, shed some blood, and come back with an arm gone, or took a leg or shrapnel in the side of them. Brother, I tell you what, we got too many wounded feelings and not enough genuine scars. Oh, listen, have you ever heard, Brother Pastor? Well, my husband, he came there for a while, but he got his feelings hurt. Who boy told me the other day? He said, Brother Wolf, I've been hurt. I really have. Oh, and the wife was over there sort of pacifying a little bit, said, yeah, he's been hurt deeply. He didn't receive the proper recognition. They do not appreciate my husband's ability and his great talent. Mm-hmm. You know what they told me? They said, we ain't dead yet. Dead people don't get the feelings of it. I've never preached a funeral and a fellow raised up and said, I've been hurt deeply. I've never been to a funeral and a corpse raised up his head and said, I just wanted to see you all this evening. Wanted to see how loyal my friends were to me. Brother. He's dead. Dead! Brother, he said, if you be risen with Christ, seek those things which are upstairs above. You won't find it on the lower level. I swear everybody's looking for it, but it ain't down there, boy. You got to walk them golden stairs to find and to get into heaven, did you know that? And the only way you can walk those stairs is by faith. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? He should go up before him. Amen. He'll go up before him. What about who are you growing up before? He should go up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form, not comeliness. And when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. Still not much beauty to Jesus for the world. Now, isn't it pitiful? As far as I'm concerned, there's nothing ugly about Jesus, but the world just don't go for him. The world. You know, one of these nights, I want to preach on the other side of Jesus. He told them one day, he said, let's go to the other side. Most people live and die and never see the other side of Jesus. We got to, in this generation, they talk about the freaks, you know. Freaks. They talk about Jesus. Brother, he don't make a freak out of you. He'll knock all the freak out of you. Hey. But, you know, we've got a little Jesus with long, wavy hair. He's so gentle and so simple and so sweet. He has diabetes. A lot of sugar in the blood, you know. I mean, that's the Jesus of this generation. Maybe next Sunday afternoon we'll just take a look at the other side. I think the sermon subject when Jesus turned the tables on. I tell you, brother, we need to turn and to turn the tables on this unbelieving generation. Well, he said, he shall grow up before him, see, as a tender plant, root out of a dry ground, hath no form to come. Did you know the Bible said that the ark was made out of gopher wood? Do you realize that gopher wood won't grow except outside in a tough place? Did you know that gopher wood is the toughest wood? And that they had to go out and get the gopher wood. They didn't get it in there amongst all of the little junk, you know, and little saplings. Gopher wood made the ark. Did you know that? I mean, that ark had to be pretty solid. Did you know many logs on that old ark? I imagine a lot of floating elephants and everything else hit that ark. And I imagine it had to take... Did you know that it floated for more than a year and didn't leak a drop? Did you know that the Bible doesn't record a thing about a bailing crew?
That's right.
Did you know they didn't have any pumps to pump the water out of it? You know why? It didn't leak a drop. You know what that ark represented? It wasn't Noah's ark. That's a bunch of malarkey. That's God's ark.
Amen.
Then Noah's ark had sunk the first 3 days. Man, never did build anything that floats very long. And so, Noah said, we're going to go get some gopher wood. And then he said, we're going to pitch it within and without with pitch. That'll stop the leaks right there. You know what keeps my salvation from leaking? The blood of Jesus. Got it pitched within and without. Amen. Did you get that? Within and without. See? The devil can't get in, I can't get out.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, I tell you, you'll never enjoy God's salvation until you know you got it.
Amen.
Permanent. Permanent. You talk about maximum security. Oh, I wish I had one night to maximum security. We got guards around the clock at our home. In Corpus Christi. Never sleep. Never sleep. 24 hours a day, those eyes. And yet them little old girls were still. Somehow, one got away, you know. This past 2 days, we got her back. Sent the plane after old Morgan went and got her yesterday morning. I mean, she'd already made it down the road to Livingston, Texas. And they picked her up and locked her up. The little thing sitting there in the juvenile jail. They called us, and she finally told them where she's from. And she's heading back toward Tennessee, and she wanted to get on up toward Chicago and so forth because some old boy, you know, little old bitty girl, and not very old, and there she was locked up in the jail. He brought her back, sent the plane there. You can't imagine how many trips we've made in the plane to pick up little runaways. Three little old girls ran, you remember, not long ago, and great big old black criminal came along and picked them up. Just got out of the prison, took them over to the apartment and sort of kept them 3 or 4 days. The little girls haven't got sense enough to know what danger they're in. How filthy and dirty and ungodly. Oh, my soul. And a colored lady across the street called and said, I think 3 of your girls are over here across the street. And so took the handcuffs and went over there and picked them up and brought them back. I've never seen such wicked, bold little sinners as we see today. Little old girls, why? They get out on the highway and stomach and don't make any difference who picks them up.
That's right.
And nothing but vultures ever pick them up unless they bring them back. Of course, every once in a while, some of my friends pick them up and said, well, what are you doing? He said, oh, I'm going to see Uncle John and Aunt Emma. I'm traveling to see my grandmother. And he said, So he just makes the 180. And he drives up in the yard and said, I believe this is where you came from, isn't it? Yes, sir. But the devil's dirty crowd never bring them back. They use them and abuse them and kick them out. One of my little girls ran 2 years ago
2 years ago, little old Chris Lincoln. I miss my love, that little old girl. And I could tell you a lot of things. And how the daddy brought her down. She's a member of 7 or 8 kids. He's in the service and brought her to Corpus.